Go. If you're new to the sketch sessions, welcome. My name is Carolyn Peters. I'm owner of Kira Studios, which is where it's like a studio in Orange where I teach traditional drawing skills so you can express anything that you have in mind with a really solid foundation. I do these weekly sketch sessions to give you a place to report to. It's often nicer to just have a group to draw with, and it's even better if then within that group there is a structure set up for you where the coach pretty much figured out, okay, today we're studying this, and this is going to be the focus, and you just have to show up and do the work. And so that's kind of the role I see myself to have. And so I cycle through four different subject matters. Every week we rotate. So there's figure, portrait, animals, and then the last big umbrella is things, like inanimate objects. So tonight falls under the things umbrella, and I picked trees. I like to pick things from nature. And then with every week, not only do we rotate subject matter, but we also rotate the focus. So sometimes we focus on proportions, other times we focus on form. And tonight I wanna focus just on a specific technique or a specific material, and that is pen and ink. Just because I have this love relationship with pen and ink, I used to be so scared of it until I figured out that I can do an underdrawing and then do the pen and ink over the underdrawing. Go figure, it took me a while. If you've been here before, welcome back. Good to see you again. I guess you get to see me, I don't get to see you, but you know what I mean. So before we dive in, I have some video footage queued up for us. I timed a bunch of beautiful tree imagery, ranging from 3 minutes to 5 minutes to 15 minutes. In the beginning, I'm just gonna focus on shape and silhouettes, and then I'll dive into some longer drawings and I'll play with different materials. So if you're anything like me, you have a whole assortment of pen and ink. And if you are anything like I used to be, I used to have no idea what to do with them all. So I want to spend just a couple more minutes talking about the different types, and then we'll dive right into the footage and draw together. All right, so the main distinction you want to make between your pen and ink tools is, are you using it for a linear purpose, or are you using it for a tonal purpose? Meaning, do you want to establish value with it, or do you want to establish more contour-driven details with it? So let me show you a few tools that are good for linear drawing. This year, everybody has that one. This is just an old Bic ballpoint pen, and it's great for both. You can make this go into value, but you can also use it just for line. Then these would be your next choice, or your next possibility rather, if I get a little bit closer. These are fine liners. So for those, they're really better for line driven drawings, unless you have a really long time to work on your pen and ink drawing and you want to have a very meticulous, well-structured, well-organized way of hatching your values. So you can get values with these, but you'd have to hatch in a very organized and calm and careful way. So I prefer using the fine liners just for contour-driven drawings. Let's go to the next one. So many fun tools. And if nothing else, if for some reason I keel over tonight because of the heat and woozy headedness, this will give you a reason to go to the art supply store or go online and go shopping for some fun pen and ink tools. That will be a success. So the next type of pen and ink tool looks like this. I don't know if you can see this. So these are brush-tipped pens, nylon brush-tipped pens. And I love them for a variation of contour-driven and linear-driven quick sketches. They're pretty bold, so you wanna use them if you wanna make quick, bold judgments where you don't wanna second guess yourself, where you don't wanna backpedal. You just wanna go for it and just within a couple of minutes, throw something down. That's what I use these nylon tipped markers for. Then here's another favorite of mine. I have a couple more I want to show you. So these are like this, Chinese brush pens with ink in them. I love them because you can get the super fine line quality with it, or you can just push hard and get like a nice broad stroke. So you can get go in and out of fine and bold. Whereas, for example, these fine liners, you just get one thickness in your stroke. So here you can vary from thick line to thin line. It's very organic. It's great for gesture. So I highly recommend you grab one. And I think this one is, although this one is a Pentel, but there is one by Kuretake that I really like. Last two things I want to show you. These guys here, I used to be so terrified of them. I don't know why. Well, I know why, because I didn't know what they are used for. So these are Copic markers. And Copic markers, they come in all kinds of colors. I like to get different values. So you see the caps. There's a light one, a really dark one, and a middle one. So these are the different values. And depending on what side you use, you can either use a fairly broad tip, or you can use the brush tip, but even the brush tip is fairly chunky. Here, let me put it like this, fairly chunky. So I consider these a pure value producer. They're not so much a line producer in my book. So whenever you just want to lay in some local value, like the green of the foliage, that's what I would use. And then I like to pair this. So this is my favorite combo, and I'll do a drawing with this. I like to pair this with a nylon brush tip. This will give me the linear quality. This will give me the tonal quality. And the last thing I want to share with you before we dive into our tree footage, good old traditional, the really traditional stuff. So just Indian ink. I like waterproof, so you can go over it with washes and not have it dissolve back up at you. And then just a good old nib with a nib holder. And I love that. And for those, I usually use them in combination with a brush that I dip into ink washes. And so again, we always want to combine tonal with linear. So this first image that I'll share with you is a image with a bunch of trees. And I'll be doing silhouette studies. So I timed the first image for 5 minutes. So I'm gonna begin with just a Bic pen. So if you're watching and you don't have all these fancy tools, but you probably have a ballpoint pen someplace, you can grab that and get started with me with a ballpoint pen. And then we can dive in and explore the different methods and techniques. So 5 minutes for the first image. There are multiple trees on that image, so you can do multiple trees. So let me switch. Oh, Keisha just said that you're used to be terrified to Copics, or at least you can relate. Glad I'm not the only one. But you know, once you know how to use them, they're actually really fun. Okay, so let me get my screen switched over. Transition. So you should see the trees and my drawing board. Let me make sure this is actually focused. And let's hit play and let's have some fun. So I like to think of these sessions as workout sessions where you train a very specific skill. But at the same time, I also like to think of them as play sessions. So training is all good and fun, but the fun part is more important to me. Just like having a good time. If it all lights on fire and turns out horrible, I'll choose to laugh about it and come back next time, hopefully clear. So as I said earlier, because it's so hot here, I'm really dizzy today. I don't know what it is. So, but still, I show up. I love drawing. I prioritize that in my life. And if the result is not as great as I want it to be, as long as I sat down and drew, hey, that was a successful day for me. So that's how I choose to look at my drawing practice. I like to think of it as a practice, not as a performance. Let me make sure this is actually focused. I think it is. So I'm drawing the tree that's kind of on the left-hand side, and I'm just kind of going for the big outer shape. I'm kind of trying to capture the character of it. And once I have that, because I said I was just going to do a quick silhouette study, I then just shade this in. And when I say I shade it in, I don't mean that I pay particular attention to the lightness and dark variations. So I'm not thinking, oh, where is the shadow on this tree? Where is the light on this tree? And let me reflect the difference between the two. When I create silhouette studies, I shade in one direction. You see how all my marks go in one direction? Oh, Chris, this is funny that you say that. I have actually, I don't know if you can see this, I have this. This is a sports drink from my husband. He works at a game company that makes a video game for cyclists. And so they get all this like sporty equipment often handed to them. And so I grabbed one of these electrolyte caffeine thingies. So hopefully that'll bring me back to life. And if for some reason I stopped talking and I fell off the drawing bench, you guys just keep drawing. The video will keep going. The trees will keep being trees, and you can keep drawing. But thanks for checking in with me. I know it's easy to get dehydrated. Okay, so I consider this to be done, so I'm now gonna move on to the next tree. Let's do a brush pen one. Okay, so this is this Chinese brush pen. And I told you in the intro that you can vary between these super fine lines and these more chunky, thicker marks. So it's perfect for trees because you can get the wispies of the foliage very easily indicated. And the one I'm using today is actually a dark gray. It's a dark gray, not a black. So if you're kind of a little bit shocked also when you put a marker down at how dark it is and it kind of throws you back a little bit, I highly recommend beginning just with a gray one rather than a black one. Now, if you've been to my drawing sessions, to my sketch sessions, if we talk gestures, and I would consider this a gesture study, because what are gestures? Gestures are just a big picture, right? So when we look at the big picture, check in with what do we have to do? What's that thing she always says about gestures? We have to visually zoom out. Because only when we make our eyes zoom out can we actually see the entirety. Oh man, what, I missed the trunk on that one. All right, so this one is just 3 minutes. I use one of the nylon tipped ones right now. So see, that one is much darker. So when you use one of the markers that are just like, you know, a little bit unforgiving, you wanna lean into that. You don't want to tiptoe. You just want to embrace that this is going to make a dark mark and just not run away from it. So I'm gonna get my tree trunk in this time. So speaking about the big picture and gestures and all that, like if this was a figure drawing session, you would hear, and this was about gestures, you'd hear me talk about, well, it's only a gesture if all the body parts are there. So if this is a tree gesture, it's only a tree gesture if all the tree parts are there. Which is a little bit unfair, because trees just have way too many limbs. With people, we only have two arms and two legs to deal with. So I guess we're a little bit off the hook when it comes to trees. So see again, as I'm laying in the mass of the tree, I'm just shading in one direction. I'm not reflecting light and shadow at this point. I'm just reflecting positive mass and negative space. So positive mass or positive space is parts that are actual tree. And negative space are things that are basically, in this case, just the sky. So the other thing about kind of being timid and being a little bit shocked at how dark ink is and embracing the fact that you can't erase it, the more you lean into that and the more you are okay with kind of making marks that aren't right, the more your own artistic style will come out. So style, I have come to understand, it can be something that you put on, but then I feel like it's not truly yours. It's just, you know, then you're just copying somebody else. But like your own personal style, your own personal visual signature comes out when you let go of copying. And you're okay with incorporating some degree of mistakes into your drawing. You can tell me if you agree or disagree with that. Or how you think of style. I'd be curious to hear. And I know when we're drawing, it's sometimes hard to type at the same time. So maybe at the end you can type in your answer for that. Like, what's your idea of style? Just take another sip. So as I said, in these tree silhouette studies, I'm only focusing on mass, or like if you want to say in a different word. Like I'm not looking at texture at this point. I'm not looking so much at detail. I'm indicating detail a little bit, but I'm more interested like when I squint. If I had to cut, like this is the best analogy I have. If I had to cut this tree out and it still looked like the tree in front of me, that's what I'm drawing right now. Or even better analogy, if I handed this drawing to my neighbor who didn't see the photograph, I told him, hey, cut out the tree for me. He'd know exactly where to cut, or she. And once they cut out the silhouette, it would look really close to the image, the reference image. That's how I like to think about whether it's a successful silhouette. And now, why are silhouettes so powerful? I think they're very underestimated, disregarded. But if you think about it, the silhouette is where the emotional connotation is, the emotional power. So the trees, they can look quite like a personality. But that personality does not lie in the details. The personality lies in how that tree carries itself. That's why we like to think of them as anthropomorphized. Oh, Bill, I like that. Style develops from how someone solves problems. Right, and I think those problems, they come from making possible mistakes. You know, it's like, oh shoot, I didn't capture this quite right. Now what I do? So I'm in line with you there. Okay, so this is a 15 minute pose. So I'm gonna switch into a slower way of building my drawing. So let's go for the Copic ones, huh? So if you've always been curious about how to use Copic markers, so here's my dirty trick, my dirty secret. I do an underdrawing and I don't feel one bit apologetic about it. And I'm sure there are purists who are like face palming hard, thinking, well, they're not really doing pen and ink then, and they may do that. I'm glad I'm not in their camp. So when I do an underdrawing, in general, I like to use a very hard graphite pencil. I used a slightly softer one today, so it will show up on the screen. But the harder your pencil, the less it'll smudge. Okay, so I'm looking at the big picture at this point, and I have a slight underdrawing. I want to stop, I want to pause. Ooh, I kind of like the rocks going like this. I want to stop and pause, zoom out, and check if I feel like I have the personality of the tree. And again, the personality is in the big picture. So I'm looking at that big enveloping shape, make adjustments to that. So again, big enveloping shape. If you've never been in my drawing sessions, it's a game that you play with your drawing. It's a game of playing, okay, let's say I only have five long sticks that I arrange around whatever it is that I'm drawing, person, tree, bubblegum. What angles do I see? Okay. Again, I pause one more time, zoom out, lean back. Once I feel like, okay, this is good enough, I got it, I can go two ways. And I haven't really found one way that I prefer. I can either start working my way around the contour with my fine liner or with my felt tip marker, looking at details, indicating texture, starting to capture some of the smaller contours around the trunk and branches, and then put tone over it. Or I can begin with the tone. So I'm going to begin with the tone. And I think I might have talked about this in a previous session, maybe during one of the portrait sessions where we talked about value. There are different aspects that make up value. There is this idea whether something is light or shadow, as in like, is the sunlight hitting it or is the lamplight hitting it, or is the light being blocked, light rays can't reach, and things are therefore in shadow. That's one element of value. The other element of value is one that I will be addressing a lot tonight, and that is local value. Now, what is local value? Local value is the inherent pigment of something. If you're thinking about people, that's our skin pigmentation. You have dark skin, light skin. You have skin parts that are more tan because they have more sun exposure, like your head and forearms. And then portions of your body where the skin isn't so exposed to sunlight and is therefore lighter. That's local value. And for trees, that local value right now is how dark is the green of the foliage? How dark is the bark? The thing about local value is that you want to apply it in a flat manner, meaning evenly. And once you have it, you can then separately, in another pass, address light and shadow. So you can literally tease apart the many components that make full value. As I'm laying in the local value on this tree, you want to be mindful of your sky holes. So anywhere where there's sky looking through, you want to reserve those areas. Because that's the thing, like once the ink is down, you can't backtrack. And that is why, especially if it's not just a quick sketch, especially if it's a longer drawing that I'm working on, what was I gonna say? I wanna take my time. I wanna make sure that I get the details in the right spots. That's what I was gonna say. Okay, so see at this point, I began fairly light. So how do you see local value best? You see local value best at the edges. So anywhere you have one thing touch the other. So here, foliage against sky, trunk against sky. Like when you squint, you see that the tree overall is darker than the sky. At least that's what I think. Let's get to these darker trunk portions. I usually prefer working with the brush tip side of the Copics. Simple thing about trees, this is obvious once I say it, but sometimes we forget the obvious things when we draw. As the branches move away from the trunk, they need to taper. They need to become slimmer. So that's sometimes when your drawing looks a little bit strange, that's often a quick fix. So I'm starting to address a little bit shadow areas against light areas. And a really useful way of thinking about where to put your shadows is you want to think about every branch has a cluster of foliage, like a pillow. So say every branch has a pillow of foliage, whether it's needle foliage, or leaf foliage, and every pillow has a top, side, bottom, and other side. And so when you think about every foliage cluster, every foliage cloud, And it's just a simple form in space where certain areas are going to catch the light and other areas are going to be turned away from the light. It becomes all of a sudden really easy to place your darks. I don't know how much time we have left on this one, but I feel like I'm running out. And I'm anxious to get to my liner part, just so I can show you the combo. So once I have that, I'll work on indicating texture with my nylon tip markers. Now texture is not so useful in the middle of your shapes. Texture is really at its best at the edges, whether it's the edges of a little foliage proof or whether it's the edges of a shadow mask. And see, when I'm indicating this texture, I'm just basically coming up with a shorthand. Like, I'm not copying individual needles here. Nobody's got time for that. It's just that whatever shorthand I come up with, I base it off of the characteristics of that particular plant. So this one has like these little, I don't even know what to call them, tufts that come out. So I make sure that I have a bunch of those characteristic tufts in there. I don't do this. I don't have an uninterrupted line. I break up my lines of texture. And these can be quite repetitive, these texture shorthands. And there's some really awesome books. There's one by Dover. I can't think of the title right now. If I see it on the bookshelf, I'll read it out to you later. I think, yeah, Rendering in Pen and Ink. It's by Guptil. Guptil. There's some beautiful practice pages of very classical pen and ink texture shorthands. So if you're using a nib, you definitely want to get your hand on one of those books. So I think his name is Arthur Guptil, I want to say. Rendering in Pen and Ink. You can get that very inexpensively. I got my copy of the book on Amazon, just used a couple of bucks. And see, now I use my liner, my contour, along the outer edges. And I can even bring it inside, and like if there was like some great texture on the trunk that I was interested in, I would spend some time on that as well. I love this technique because it's so versatile. Like, I can do a 15-minute sketch with Copics and nylon tip markers, or I can do the same exact strategy, just taking much more time with the underdrawing, more time with establishing the ink washes, so I get like a truer or more rendered value rendition, and use my traditional ink nibs with a dipping pen. And when I place little branch details, I'm again being pretty selective about which ones I choose. I'll choose the interesting ones and also where I place them. Okay, I would just lean back thinking, oh, this is coming along pretty nicely, so I'm pleased. Okay, let's go to the next one. So I have two more, so this one and then one more. Let me see, what other technique do I want to show you guys? You know what, I'm going to render one just in ballpoint pen. And I'm going to do it without an underdrawing. So in my sketchbook, if I just draw for fun, I don't mind having traces of my underdrawing. Like, who am I kidding? I don't have to impress anybody in my sketchbook. So I know that I use underdrawings, and so I don't, you know, bother with erasing the traces of it. Like if this is, if I were working on a, let's say a commissioned piece of art, and it's supposed to have a highly rendered finish, or if this was like for a comic book where you need that polished, finished look, then of course I'd do a graphite underdrawing and be sure to erase it all. But so here, I just wanna show you how I'd go about just sketching for fun if all you have is just a ballpoint pen. So what I love about ballpoint pens, and there's some that do this better than others, is that you can get a very wide range of lightness and darkness. Like you can control the pressure pretty well. It's much harder to control the pressure with these nylon tipped guys. But here, like you can kind of ease your way into your drawing. And so at this stage, of course, like always, I begin with the big silhouette. Again, what's the big mass distribution? And once I have that, I start to tease out those smaller sub-shapes. I'm not quite sure, does this belong to the tree? I think it belongs to the tree down here, so I'm just going to include it. I don't know if any of you know the painter George Innes. He's absolutely wonderful, 1800s American landscape painter. Let me put it into the chat so it's there for everybody. And I never know if it's two N's or not, but Innes, George. I'm just completely in love with his paintings. And the reason I just had to think about him is because, you know, I was just thinking about, does this belong to the tree or not? And it kind of goes back to what you were saying, Bill. It's like, how do you solve problems? So George Innes, somebody, he was very famous at this time. Somebody asked him, oh, what's this thing in the bottom left corner of your painting there? It kind of looks like a guy with a wheelbarrow. And then the painter, Innes, was saying, oh yeah, I had no idea either, but yeah, you're right, it could be somebody with a wheelbarrow. And I'm bringing this up because it doesn't matter often if you know what it is that you're drawing, as long as you capture it decisively and make it part of the whole that you're orchestrating. So for me down here, I'm just gonna make this part of the tree. And maybe it turns out that it was not, but you know what? That's the problem I solved. That's my rendition of this tree, and nobody else will do it exactly my way. And that's the beauty of art. We come up with our own solutions. Okay, so check this out. At this point, I had the big picture. Now I have the segmentations. And if you're not very practiced in organizing your details in a way where you lose sight of the entirety, I would grab my pencil and I'd begin like this. I'm just going to give you a little sub drawing at the bottom. So let's say this was your beginning lay in, and now you want to do the sub segments. Count out, okay, how many big segments do I see on this left side? 1, 2, 3, 4. And you go, okay, 1, 2, 3, 4. And you kind of give yourself like little beginning points, and then you can work on making them look more like what you see. So guardrails, give yourself guardrails. Okay, so now that I have this, I'm gonna switch into my local value. The way you establish local value is evenly, meaning I'm not doing this. I'm not scribbling. I'm just being pretty organized, and I'm spacing my hatch marks pretty close together. Now, before I go too far ahead, I'm gonna pause and scan if there are any sky holes or air holes. Because like down here, where was it? So this is here. This is not really a sky hole, but it's an air hole. I can see the mountain through it. And I don't want to shade over that. So that, I got this one over here, and then there's one more here. I'm glad I paused. Those air holes are really important. Okay. Carry on with the shading. So here's something to ponder. So the way I like to teach is I like to teach techniques, I like to teach principles, but I always like to, especially in my courses, like if you take a full course with me, I always like to connect these insights to you as an individual artist, and how you can take now these principles and truly find who you are as an artist. So what I want you to consider tonight is, what's your relationship with chance in your art making? And what I mean by that is, like, what's your relationship with shit happening, with mistakes happening, with things not quite going the way that you thought they would? Does that frustrate you? And you then get pissed off and throw pencils and storm off and vow that next time you'll be working in a much more controlled manner? Or do you lean into that and say, oh shit, I didn't want to do that. Oh, well, let's see. Well, what can I do now? How can I solve this problem? How can I keep going? Can I still pull this off? Is it a lost cause? Like, what's your relationship with unforeseen things? I don't know what how else to say it. And you know, I wouldn't be too judgmental about whatever your answer is. You know, if your answer is, yeah, it pisses me off, and yeah, I'm gonna be more controlled next time, and I'm gonna get this really foolproof method, and I'm gonna work that way, like, you know, that's just been your personality, and I would lean into that part. But if you're like thinking that, oh, just the thought of that, that kind of stifles me, and I don't like that at all, then start to seek out artists who seem to have like a healthy relationship with that precarious, is that the word? I don't know, like with that kind of danger loving or accident embracing mentality. And Ines is a really great example for that. So as you can see, if I have to build my local value, with ballpoint pen, it takes some time, and I better speed up or I won't get very far with this one. Because ideally I want to get to a point where I don't just have the silhouette, I want to get to a point where I get to the light dark distribution. Bob Ross, happy accident. That's right. Don't discount Bob. And it's funny though, because I think, you know, he had so many, how do you say, tricks up his sleeve. They were quite, I don't know. It's like he knew that certain tricks would yield certain results, you know, so it's not like a new solution every single time. Like he would use old solutions all over, but he was well aware that that shit would happen, and he just had enough tools in his toolkit that he could use whenever necessary. Interesting. Bill, I was just reading your comment about jewelry. Yeah, you know, that's such a good point. Like once you're invested, then you better pull something out of it. And I think for visual artists, for people who draw and paint, it's a little bit of a double-edged sword, because there is then this tendency to get precious. You know, like, oh, it's the $10 paper, I better make something good, you know? And you kind of want to, I don't know, like for me, it's been a combination of, you know, I practice a lot on crap materials. So when I do work on the pricier stuff, I feel pretty confident that I have a lot of solution remedies available to me. So I wouldn't suggest to a beginner to buy the expensive paper. But your point is super well taken. Like I totally get what you mean. And again, coming back to this being a double-edged sword, if you don't have any investment, then you can let yourself off the hook all the time and you'll never grow. So you want to find that sweet spot, like what gives you just a little bit of tension and just enough buy-in to stick with it. And I think that's why classes are so effective. That's why I participate in classes that I pay good money for, because I know, well, I paid X amount of dollars and I don't want to feel like they're wasted, so I better work my ass off and get my money's worth. And it's usually, you know, yes, of course, whatever the teacher is offering, that's worth the money. But it's really my effort that I'm paying for. I'm making myself work hard because I spent money. So yeah, again, like gotta find whatever works for you to keep you motivated, not frozen. So you guys, I hope you can see what I'm doing with this tree. Same principle. I'm looking at the cluster. Every foliage cluster belongs to a certain branch, and every foliage cluster has a top that's being hit by light and a bottom that's not being hit by light. And I am just going poof by poof and knowing that I don't have a lot of time, I'm not being very finicky about, oh, is this perfect? Is this in the right spot? I'm just kind of using my tree reference as a jumping off point. For the last tree, are there any techniques you want me to demo? Were there any materials you're like, oh, I'd love to see you do a 15-minute drawing with that one? So Kija, what are you saying? You're saying, one day I thought about, mistakes used to bother me a lot until recently, now embrace them as a part of the learning process. One day I thought about it for a while, and I came to the conclusion that it was kind of egotistic of me to think I'm not going to have mistakes when I still have a long. You know, that's such a healthy attitude, and I think it's a really freeing attitude. Boy, do I wish that there weren't any mistakes in my drawings. Like, I share this very freely in my newsletters and on Instagram. I totally have perfectionist tendencies, but I like to think of myself as a recovering perfectionist who, you know, doesn't let herself get stifled by that. Chinese brush. I was hoping somebody would say that. Great, I'll do the Chinese brush, but I'll begin with an underdrawing. Okay, so this is our last drawing. So yeah, I think, you know, embracing the fact that we make mistakes makes us more human. It makes us a bit more bearable as people, you know? If that makes any sense. And just on a purely artistic, creative level, it makes our art more engaging, at least I think so, because you're not putting up a facade. Like, you can taste the blood, sweat, and tears that goes into. The drawing or the painting. Okay, so under drawing, I'm looking at the big shapes. So I'm seeing that this here is coming down, up, over. So I will also say, this is something to consider, as you go through your array of pen and ink tools that you may have, certain trees will call for certain tools. And let's say you have an oak tree. You know how they have like very dense, rounded foliage proofs. For something like that, I'd want to choose a material that allows me to get in detail with the value. Now, something like this, where you have lots of thin branches and then some foliage, I want to have variation. So I think the Chinese brush is going to be perfect for this. Okay, so let me check. So I have this, I have this next one. So now I'm gonna spend some time. I think I can make this bigger without it coming off screen. Just a sec here. Pull this, bring it over. Okay, like that we can see a little bit better. So I'm gonna spend a little bit of time like plotting out the major branches. You can even think about it as branch clusters. Like, here's a branch cluster with one, two, three, something like that. So all of these photos that we're working from today, I took those last week or week and a half ago. We took a little trip. So I've been holed up in our house ever since the pandemic. And, you know, I homeschool my kid now, and I work from home, and my husband works from home. So we've been like at home, and it was well overdue that we got out of the house. And so we finally got to the mountains and just hiking every day. You know, I mean, you know, my girl is almost 5, so she can't hike that long, but we hiked for an hour or so. And it was just so nice soaking up the quiet and then just the majesty of these beautiful trees. So getting to draw them tonight with you guys just makes me so happy. I hope you have something similar that you can draw in the next few days that will kind of recall a moment of delight. Okay, so I got everything figured out or plotted out. I'm gonna go a little bit differently. I'm gonna begin texturally now. So see, I have the super fine point here, and I'm gonna use that to add the edges. Indicate the nature of this particular type of tree. One. Oh man, time is always running out. Let me see how much we have. Okay, so we have about 9 minutes left on this. The other thing when you're working with pen and ink, it's important that you can have a downward movement with your pens, especially if you work with a traditional dipping pen. Like if you work uphill, all the ink will flow down and eventually you won't make a mark. So if you're working on a desk rather than on an easel where your surface is kind of horizontal, that's often better for pen and ink supplies. Again, I'm gonna look at, okay, where air holes. So here is your chance to solve a problem. So you see right in here, there are lots of branches. So lots of smaller air holes. And the tension is that we don't have a lot of time. So where are we gonna indicate those branches and where are we gonna mass over it? So again, in case you're interested, this is a Pentel brush pen, and it's a gray one. I have some black ones too, and I love those too. Let me see if I have it nearby. Yeah, there it is. I'm just gonna pick it up for you so you can see it too. So this is a Coretake black one. Same idea. But if you're just a little bit intimidated by ink, I recommend you get a dark gray. Same for the Copic markers. Just get a couple of different gray tones. However, what I do recommend if you use the Copic markers is that you choose one temperature of gray. So either go for the warm grays and get some lights and darks there, or go for the cool grays and go get lights and darks there. I haven't found a technique yet where I'm comfortable combining the warms and cools. And I'm sure there is a technique, it's just not something I can teach yet. But if I ever come across one and I like it, I'll share it with you guys. But yeah, so for now, I have the cool grays. I have the more bluish grays. So warm and cool in relationship to grays means bluish grays are cool. And then brownish grays are warm. Because brown gives a little bit of extra color theory. 101 that you didn't know you're gonna get tonight. A brown is basically a muted red, and a red is a warm pigment. Blue is on the cool side of the color wheel. And so bluish grays will count as a cool color. So again, why do we love the Chinese brush? Because you can go in and out of super fine details and thicker, quicker tone marks all in one sitting. You know what we can try? If I hurry up enough, we can try doing some linear work over it with a dark, with a black one. We'll see. So in these sketch sessions, you know that we always work with timed reference material. And I really like that, not because it stresses us out, because I know that that is an effect that timed poses, especially with figure drawing, that's one effect that timed reference has. You know, it kind of puts the adrenaline into our bodies. But what I love about it is once you can get over that, once you can dance with that a little bit, it forces you to make decisions. It kind of forces you to basically lean into your style, to develop your style quicker than you would if you had all the time in the world. And there is, just as always, there is a time and place for both. See what I did just here? I was running out of ink. And so I squirted a bunch of ink out just to kind of re-saturate the brush tip. The stuff that's happening off screen here. And the thing that I do in terms of not getting stressed out, and not beating myself up if the timed drawings didn't work out the way I wanted them to. I just sit down and have a conversation with myself. There's a lot of, you know, we talk to ourselves all the time anyways, right? Like whether it's in our heads and unknowingly, and we kind of say things like, oh, that session sucked, or I didn't do any good drawings. Or whether it's like, oh, I did great. But most of the times it's negative self-talk that we have going on in our heads. And so what I do with kind of starting to arrive at my own style is I scan those quick drawings where I was forced to make decisions quickly as unjudgmentally as possible, but as curiously as possible, and scanning for like, where are interesting areas that happened that I didn't plan, that I had no, like this was not planned, not intended, that I was gonna make marks like that. And then I just savor them. Because I believe like if we do that, if we kind of become aware of the things that we like in our artwork, we'll end up doing more of that. It's like welcoming somebody to a party, saying, oh, hey there, you're nice. Come back next time. And rather than ignoring them, like, you know, your friends or like a new person is not going to come back to your party if you completely ignore them for the whole time. That's how I like to think about it, at least. So I know we're getting really close to time. Yeah, we have like 30 seconds left, but I did want to add a few more marks. Bummer. Okay, I'm gonna do it anyway, so just hang on for another minute or so and then we'll log off. Test. You know, and these brush pens, what I love too about them is once they get older and they start to dry out, they're perfect for doing gestures. It's almost like you're drawing with like a dried out vine charcoal piece, something faint. So right now I'm just scanning for darker accent opportunities. I'm looking for them in the shadow areas. So I'm not putting the dark everywhere. I'm being selective about it. If you have questions about Pen and Ink, about anything else we talked about tonight, now's your time to pop something into the chat. There's always a little bit of lag in the chat, so I'm saying it now. Any artists you wanna share? If you wanna, I don't know how many people are watching. I have to make the window so small so I never see how many people are on. But if anybody else wants to share their relationship to chance in your drawings, I'd love to see it. And of course, as always, I'd love to see your artwork. I'd love to see what you came up with. No matter how impressive or not, I just want to give you support. I want to give you acknowledgement that you show up, that you make drawing a big part of your day-to-day. We need more people who prioritize creativity. So if you want to share your artwork, you can find me on Instagram at Kira Studios. You can just tag me there or send me a DM. All right, so I'll have to call it. That's not all that bad. So again, like, if push comes to shove, what choices do you make where? It can yield to interesting results. So that was the Chinese brush pen. So let me switch over real quick. All right, well, thank you so much for drawing with me tonight. It was really fun. I hope you learned something new. Just to kind of summarize again, I like to always kind of wrap a bow around the session at the end. So here are some things you want to consider when you work in pen and ink. The first thing is you want to know your tools. Within the time frame that you have, are you aiming for a value-driven drawing? Or are you aiming for a contour and detail-driven drawing? For the contour detail-driven drawing, you want to have fine points, like fine liners, like the traditional nib, like nylon tips, I guess. If you want to have more tone-driven drawings or combo, you want to use something that will give you quick results, like ink washes, Copic markers, or the nylon tipped brush pens that just put tone down a little bit more directly. So those are your two main options, right? What do you choose? You can, of course, just use a ballpoint pen and then go either way. Let's see, what else do I want to share? Oh yeah, the last is the simplest point, is that if you plan on making a drawing that should be frameable or that you want to gift to somebody, then really invest in a solid underdrawing in pencil. Don't feel bad about it. Use all your measuring techniques that you hopefully have learned at one point. Get your proportions laid in, have your clusters laid in, scope out your sky holes, and then either begin with your contours and details and then add the value washes, or begin with your value washes and then finish it off with some linear work. So if you go through my Instagram feed, if you scroll through kind of pretty late, I have some tree examples with Copic markers and nylon brush pens, and there's some step-by-steps. So those are still up. I explain how I do it, and hopefully that will be extra useful. So I saw, Kija, you have a note, the note about style. I think we unconsciously get influenced by the things we like, and we let them show in your drawings when we get loose. Absolutely, yes. And I think it's also, on that note, worth saying that we're not one note. We're not just wild and only like just kind of gregarious way of making art. We also have other aspects to a personality. And I think it's just healthy to embrace it all and say, oh, see right in that corner of my drawing, that's where I want to tighten it up. But then the rest, I want to have it broad strokes and open. Or one day you want to do an entire drawing in a very controlled manner. And then the next day you make a very free drawing, a gestural drawing. And they both look different, but they're both you. Like, I find that in my artwork a lot. I like these very tightly rendered controlled drawings. And then I like very loose gestural paintings. And rather than saying, well, they don't look like each other and therefore it's not me and I don't have a style, it just means, no, I have a diverse style and I use whatever I need for whatever occasion I have. So I hope this is useful. I love getting to draw with you tonight. I'm glad I didn't fall off the drawing bench. And next week we're back to figure, and I have an inkling that we're going to be drawing hands. So if you need some hand practice, join me, and good to see you guys. Oh, one more thing. In case you're new here and you're not on my mailing list, get on my mailing list. In the description below the video, there's a link saying curaoc.com/3questions. It's a link to a workbook that you get if you go on my mailing list. So it's a workbook that will make your drawings better with 3 simple questions. You get the PDF, you can download it, it's really great. And then from there on, you'll get my weekly emails, and you'll always know when I'm on YouTube, when I have anything else interesting coming down the pipelines, and yeah, we'll be better friends like that. So anyways, good to see you guys. See you next week, and take care.